Okay, thank you very much, Johan, and also good morning to everyone, and thank you for having the opportunity to talk about also the other side of the coin, as Johan mentioned in the introduction today. That is also my second main task in Danish Energy Agency. Yesterday, I talked about renewables, and my second, I am working in the heat, in the energy supply division, working also with the nationwide heat planning in Denmark. I was involved in that in the '80s, have been away for 70 years, working in the private sector, now back in the Denmark, in the new agenda for the future energy system. I'm also, we should mention, I'm working on developing of a new concept for a voluntary municipal energy planning in Denmark. There is a small subsidy scheme in the energy agreement, giving subsidies to municipalities to prepare pilot energy plans, and we are now very busy in preparing guidelines, how to map resources, energy saving potentials, how to analyze, and so on. So the municipalities, when they are starting to prepare their pilot energy plans for the entire geographical area, focusing as well demand side and supply side, have the best opportunities to prepare those pilot energy plans. And I think there's a very good very high interest in Danish municipalities to go into this new pilot area. But that was not what I should talk so much about today. I have prepared this presentation together with my colleague, Peter Bak, who has worked for many years with energy saving obligation schemes, and was heavily involved from the Danish side during the presidency to assist the presidency and cooperate with the commission regarding the energy end-use savings. And my role in this process was on the other side to assist the presidency, and I worked close together with one of Christoph's colleagues, Mrs. Eva Hoos, regarding how to develop this article about how to promote cogeneration and district heating in the energy efficiency directive. We worked closely together to prepare one of the annexes regarding how to make cost-benefit analysis, also based on Danish experiences. So also from that perspective, I think I have something to contribute with today. Then before I start, would like to urge you, invite you to take these three handouts, which I came with yesterday, my presentation from yesterday, my presentation from today, and also this leaflet about the new Danish energy agreement. I don't like to bring all this stuff back to Denmark again. So please, if you don't or not have done it so far, please take a copy with you. Hopefully, that can also be used if you want to come back later on. I have included, as you can see, my email address and also my colleague Peter Bak's email address, which I'll start to make his presentation, so to speak. So what I have prepared to do today is to focus on two Danish experiences of relevance for the implementation. The first is Article 7, Article 6 in the draft EED, for those who were following the negotiation process. This energy efficiency obligation scheme, which we have been running for a number of years in Denmark. And the second one is Article 14 or Article 10 regarding promotion of efficiency in heating and cooling. And why those two articles? They are expected to provide a major part of energy savings according to the estimates from commissions, and I think also we have some experience in that area. This diagram is also from the same meeting in Horsens, as Christoph mentioned, during the Danish presidency, where the commission made an estimate of how much the different articles should contribute to deliver energy savings. And the blue pile is stable is how to what the commission was proposed originally, and the red part is saying what how much it was expected that should be realized according to the positions at that time in Horsens in April 2002. And you can see that Article 7 and Article 14 are expected to contribute to around 37 million tons oil equivalent, and all articles should contribute with 58 million tons oil equivalent, according to the estimates from commissions. So I think also from that point of view, it is relevant to focus on those two articles in my short presentation. And I hopefully can answer questions in the next part, but if you go too much in details, maybe I will refer to my colleague back in Copenhagen, who will gladly help you. But this current saving obligation scheme has been in place since 2006. It is focusing on all the major end-use sectors, electricity sector, natural gas sector, district heating sector, and oil sector. It is involving, in practical, all the distribution companies from natural gas, electricity, and district heating, and grid companies. Then we have also included in the in the saving obligation scheme oil as a voluntary agreement between the oil companies and the Danish state. So you can say that we have all end-use sectors more or less included based on where the energy companies are working in the market on a daily basis. Danish Energy Agency is responsible for the administration. The main principles are that we will be prepared mandatory annual saving targets for all the companies, for all the sectors. There's a large freedom to deliver in the best way, the most cost-effective way for the companies, the two utilities. They can only count savings where they are direct or when they are direct or indirect involved in the implementation. That can be, I've given some examples, that can be advisory activities, energy auditing. That can be subsidies, which number of companies they are doing, making subsidies to industry in order to promote savings. They can buy savings, which the industry has done themselves, and use it to fulfill the targets. And as I mentioned, all kind of final energy consumption besides transport is included in the current obligation scheme. Losses in grids are included, in particular district heating losses. So if the district heating company do something to renovate their grid, they can also count the energy savings according to the obligation scheme. What is not included is efficiency improvement in district heating production and in power plants. So everything on the supply side is not included. It is on the end use and distribution side where the focus is. That is slightly different compared to the EEDD, but I think that's a minor issue. So the targets have been so far from 2006 to 2009. It was an annual requirement on 0.7% of consumption in the sectors included. From 2010 to 2012, based on a previous energy agreement in the parliament from 2008, it was increased to 1.5% annual final savings in final consumption. And now with the new energy agreement from 2012, the politicians has made another screw have used the screwdriver once again to tighten the screw a bit more. So now the annual target will be increased with 75%. In 2013 and 2014, and with 100% from 2015 and onwards to until 2020. So we have found that has been an efficient way to use to promote energy savings, which is that's why the politicians has agreed upon to continue with using the screwdriver in this area. Briefly about measurement of savings, there are two main methods. Standard values are being used when you are talking about small consumers, but when you are going into more larger projects, there is a required more specific calculation based on engineering methodology, and which is used for all large projects, in particular projects in industries and the public sector. not go so much too in details about verification. Of course, there's a verification scheme in place. It is the utilities themselves who are responsible for verification, documentation, reporting, and there's an independent quality control in place, and Danish Energy Agency is the overall controller of the documentation on an annual basis. This diagram is interesting, to which is showing the delivered savings in 2010, that the annual target was 6.1 petajoule, which you saw in my previous slide, and you go, and that is divided on electricity, on natural gas, on district heating, and oil companies. And what is the most interesting is that in all these subsectors, the reported savings based on and controlled by independent auditor has shown that the reported savings in 2010 was higher than was expected by was required by this agreement between the state and the companies. So in totally, these sectors had delivered a little bit more than 7 petajoule, and that means that they have delivered 16% in average compared to what they were obliged to do. So they have probably found it has been a good idea to do it. Why should they otherwise go further than the obligation? And the key message here is that the most of the financing, the activities is mainly financed through the tariffs, more or less, I think, to make it simple. That is the case for electricity price, gas price, district heating price. And that's just a part of the normal business to do that. And the consumers are paying. So that is, keep it simple, that's how it is done. Also for oil, commercial companies, I assume that have put the extra costs on the top of the selling the oil. And as many have said today and said yesterday, there are need for more savings. So looking at the long-term target for 2050, so I assume if it will continue to be a success in Denmark and there's a political will to continue, I think the Danish politician next time will use a screwdriver once again to ensure energy savings. So why it's a good idea to have this obligation scheme in place? It's a good help to secure implementation in a quite efficient way, as we have found Denmark close to the consumers, covers all part of the country. The next point is maybe not maybe an important one to focus on. It is a way to finance it outside the state budget, which in Denmark and probably the most other countries is something the state bureaucrats like. It can be maybe difficult to find money every year on the state budget. And then on a more philosophical point of view, it's a way to educate energy utilities to deliver services to the people and to the industry. They should not deliver megawatt hour, they should deliver energy services. So that is also the thinking behind, so to speak, about this saving scheme. Okay, then I come to my own business, so to speak. And maybe, I don't know how much time we have, but this is just a general introduction to how district heating was developed in Denmark. It was originally established in the larger cities, utilizing heat from central power stations, coal and heavy oil. And in the 60s, where oil was very, very cheap, a number of small district heating companies were established, supplied by heavy fuel oil, heat-only boilers. And then later on, we went into a new area in Danish energy policy, with the crisis, oil crisis in 73 and 79, where Denmark was 99% dependent of imported energy. And we made a number of very large decisions in the late 70s, beginning of the 80s, including implementation of natural gas infrastructure in Denmark. And with a large district heating system around all large coal-fired power stations in Denmark. Around 1990, all district heating areas and communities were involved in expansion and modernization of the district heating systems. Approximately 670 decentralized CSP stations based on natural gas, biomass and waste, a little bit biogas, were established in the 90s during less than 10 years and was including in total 1,500 megawatts electricity capacity, reduced CO2 emissions in Denmark by approximately 10%. And those CSP stations are owned by local district heating companies, municipalities, electricity companies, and industry. I like this map very much. It is showing the development from mid-80s to mid-late 90s, where you could see centralized CHP around the large cities, larger cities in Denmark, where there was coal-fired power plants, were using for combined heat and power planning, and through a period of a decade, the map was totally changed. Now there was these 670 decentralized CSP plants. Now I will come a little bit back to that. I think that is illustrates that if you have efficient policies in place, you can do a difference. This slide is showing how the CSP proportion of electricity and district heating has developed in this period for the last 30 years. I started as employee in Danish Energy Agency in 1981, so I have followed the most of this development inside or outside the state. Well, you can see that the CSP share in district heating changed from 40 to 80% over a period of 15 years, from mid-80s to around 2000. Hereafter stable, and you can see there is a slight decrease in district heating production the last years. The reason for that is that a number of the decentralized natural gas-based CSP plants are taking a new role, so to speak. They are now functioning as a regulating capacity, CSP capacity. The Danish TSO has made agreements with those district heating companies that they can be using as regulating capacity when you have a lot of wind in the energy system. And I see you will see the coming years that the number of the capacity will still be the same, remain the same, but you will see a slight decrease in CSP production from natural gas plants or biogas plants, maybe, but particularly natural gas plants. And they're using more heat-only boilers. So that's that has been considered to be a rather cost-effective way to integrate wind in the energy system. The other curve is showing how the electricity share has been, how many percentage of electricity has come from CHP in the same period. I will not go so much in details with this. It's showing the different phases in Danish heat planning, from urgent heat planning in the beginning of the 80s, through a nationwide heat planning in the mid-late 80s, and then there's been a stop in general heat planning for a number of years. There's been more project-specific approval by municipalities, but now we are going into, as I mentioned, into maybe a new area, new phase where we may come up with, within some years, a sector plan for energy planning, but now, until 2015, it will be on a purely voluntary basis. Okay, I'll come now to my three concluding remarks, so I hope I have the time for that, Johan. And now coming back to the directive, to Article 14 in the EE directive. And my first comment to this implementation of this article is that according to Article 14.3, all member states need to make not only financial analysis of what is seen from this, the utility point of view, you need to make socioeconomic feasibility analysis. And I'll just mention that has always been the main criteria in the Danish heat planning. However, always combined with a central determined energy policy direction, which has been different over the last three decades. In the beginning of the 80s, it was substitution of oil, then it was further use of indigenous resources. Then in the 90s, and now it has been something also broad, and now maybe now with the new energy agreement, it has been we have to substitute all kind of fossil fuels with renewables. That was number one. And the second experience I would like to brought to give to the audience is that we have also had rather good experiences with making not so much the recent years, but before, to make these nationwide heat planning activities, these comprehensive heat assessments according to Article 14.1, which was in particular, for example, was used to determine in which areas of which geographical areas of Denmark you would like to use natural gas and where there were sufficient other local resources available could be used otherwise. And this second article, Article 14.5, where there is a number of requirements to member state to make a project-specific cost-benefit analysis and some approval procedures, which has been used also in Denmark to ensure A, that the national guidelines about how the direction of the change of the system should be followed, and secondly, which may be also very important, that you through the municipal approval procedure has guaranteed that there is a local market available for use of CHP and heat-only boilers. And that I think that is something which has been can be very good for to ensure confidence security. And then my third advice, if time allows, I think that'd be very important to underline. It is very important to secure that there are sufficient instruments, economic carrots to ensure implementation. That is not a part of the EE directive because that's totally left to member states how to do that. But I have also made a very, very quick historical review, also based on my personal experiences. In the 80s, there was sufficient measures for in the heat pricing scheme, which were at that time, to giving the full CHP advantage to the heat site, which mentioned that it was cheap to switch to CHP. Then there was a period where it was a little bit more difficult. And then I will come back to my map with how you saw these 670 decentralized CSP plants was established over less than 10 years. And the reason was, besides zoning, and everyone knew what to do, the second and probably most important experience was that there was feed-in premium in place, there was investment subsidies in place, which meant that it was a very good idea from the district heating companies to switch from heat-only boilers to CHP. So I think that's also a lesson learned, which I think is very important to underline if you want to do something. And that was all. Sorry for being 5 minutes late.
I just want to ask about the decentralization of CHP. Wasn't there, aren't there any losses of efficiency? Aren't there economies of scale involved in this?
Honestly speaking, also having this review, maybe we went in Denmark a little bit too far with some of the very small CSP plants, where at that time it was feasible, but due to the rather high, due to some of the smaller towns has a rather low density of buildings, then the heat loss from the existing heating systems was substantial, and that means that maybe the smallest 50 of those have had economic problems in a period where you have increasing gas prices. In the new energy agreement, there is also there have been several packages to take care of that situation. So that is also a lesson learned that you need to be careful when you make your zoning and when you also make your incentives to ensure that you avoid that situation. So, but we have tried to cover up on this situation by assisting those district heating companies.
Thank you very much.
Well, you mentioned that you have experienced that. What is the average size of those 50 small GHBs, which are not viable anymore?
I think some of them were 5,000 inhabitants or 2,000.
I mean the capacity of the GHBs, megawatts electricity.
Yes, yes, a third question here now.
And I just wanted to compliment, because I think it might be a misunderstanding. I think the reason for these plants not always to be economic was the fact that the density of the buildings was not good enough. So the distribution network for the district heating was long. So that's why the heat losses were high, and this was the problem. You might have very small scale cogeneration, which might be still economical.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, so yeah, I think that was one of the main reasons, and the second was that during the end of the 90s, the beginning of the 80s, the last 10 years, the natural gas price has increased quite a lot. So that has also been a reason.
Okay.